Insulin resistance and type 2 diabetes are sometimes used interchangeably, but they're not the same thing. Insulin resistance is actually the root cause of type 2 diabetes, and if you catch it early enough, you can actually reverse it before diabetes develops. But what about type 1 diabetes? How is it different? And why do doctors often treat both type 1 diabetes and type 2 diabetes the same with insulin injections? Even though the problem with type 2 is there's already too much insulin. So in today's video, we're going to explain the key differences between insulin resistance, type 1 diabetes, and type 2 diabetes, why type 2 diabetes is reversible, but type 1 is not, and what's double diabetes, and how improving insulin sensitivity can benefit all three. And as always, there's going to be timestamps on the progress bar, so if you want to skip ahead to any part, feel free to do so. So let's start from the beginning and talk about what insulin resistance is. Because before we talk about diabetes, we need to understand insulin resistance. As I said at the start, insulin resistance is the root cause of type 2 diabetes. Insulin is the hormone that regulates blood sugar. When we eat carbohydrates, they're broken down into glucose, which is sugar, which enters our bloodstream. Insulin's job is to move that sugar to our cells so they can use it for energy. But when you have insulin resistance, this process isn't working properly. Your cells stop responding to insulin, sugar stays in your bloodstream instead of being absorbed, and your pancreas produces even more insulin to try to deal with the excess sugar. So for a while, this excess insulin is enough to keep your blood sugar in check. This is why in the early stages of insulin resistance, your blood sugar will look normal, but your insulin levels will be high. It's taking a lot more insulin to control your blood sugar, but eventually your pancreas can't keep up. The excess insulin isn't going to be enough. And this is when your fasting blood sugar starts to rise. At which point, you're going to be diagnosed with prediabetes or type 2 diabetes, depending on how much it's gone up. But the key thing to know here is that insulin resistance starts 5 to 15 years before this rise in blood sugar. So if you're experiencing any of the signs of insulin resistance, if you carry a lot of weight in your midsection, if you have skin tags, if you feel shaky or weak after eating, but your blood sugar is normal, just know that you can still have insulin resistance. So now let's talk about type 2 diabetes. And this is the most common type. Almost 90% of all diabetes cases are type 2. Type 2 diabetes develops after years of insulin resistance. The body is still producing insulin, but it no longer works effectively. This is when blood sugar levels remain chronically high, leading to serious health complications like nerve damage, kidney damage, and heart problems. So the main issue here is too much insulin. High chronic insulin is what causes a lot of the side effects. Now, what's important to note is that insulin resistance and type 2 diabetes are caused by diet and lifestyle choices. If you are eating a diet and making lifestyle choices that cause frequent blood sugar spikes throughout the day, this means that insulin is constantly going to be released to manage it. And high levels of insulin over time cause your cells to become insulin resistant. Like we said before, your body is going to compensate by producing more insulin, and eventually your pancreas can't keep up and fasting blood sugar starts to rise. It becomes this cycle where you have high insulin levels and this is causing insulin resistance, but then because you're insulin resistant, your insulin levels are staying high, and it just keeps getting progressively worse. And this is why a lot of doctors will refer to type 2 diabetes as a progressive disease. But spoiler alert, it's not. It can be reversed when you address the root cause, insulin resistance. And we'll get to how to do that in a couple minutes. But first, let's talk about type 1 diabetes. And this is completely different than type 2. Type 1 diabetes is an autoimmune disease. The immune system attacks the pancreas, destroying insulin-producing cells. As a result, the body produces little to no insulin. Without insulin, blood sugar remains dangerously high. Because, as you'll remember, insulin's role is to take the excess sugar from our bloodstream to our cells. So if there's no insulin or there's only very, very little insulin, then there's nothing to control blood sugar. If blood sugar remains high for too long, it can lead to nerve damage, vision loss, and even organ failure. So the key difference with type 1 and type 2 is type 1 is caused by not enough insulin and type 2 is caused by too much, but both of which can lead to high blood sugar. And this is why type 1 diabetics must take insulin in order to survive. Unlike type 2, there isn't a cure for type 1, but it can be managed efficiently with diet and lifestyle changes. And now let's talk about double diabetes. So double diabetes is where you have type 1 diabetes, but you're using so much insulin to control your blood sugar that you become insulin resistant as well, leading to you needing more and more insulin over time in order to control your blood sugar. So basically, you can only have double diabetes if you have type 1 diabetes. The good news is you can also get rid of the insulin resistant part of double diabetes, and we'll get to how to do that now. So treatment for type 1 and type 2 diabetes is often the same. Both can be treated with insulin injections, but this doesn't actually make sense. As we said, type 1 diabetes absolutely needs insulin. Their bodies aren't making any at all, and it is very, very important. We can't survive without it. Without insulin, blood sugar would rise uncontrollably, leading to severe complications. So for type 1 diabetes, insulin absolutely makes sense, but it doesn't for type 2. Because type 2 is already caused by too much insulin. When you inject insulin, it lowers your blood sugar temporarily, so it does help to control it in the short term, but it actually worsens insulin resistance in the long term. This creates a cycle where you need higher and higher doses of insulin over time because your body is becoming more and more insulin resistant. And this is why type 2 diabetes is referred to as a progressive disease, because when you're treating it with insulin, it is. Now, another common treatment for type 2 diabetes that makes a bit more sense is metformin. This is a drug that improves insulin sensitivity. So instead of adding more insulin to the already high insulin, it works by improving how your cells take in insulin, which helps to lower your insulin levels. Now, metformin can be effective, but it does come with quite a few side effects, especially digestive side effects. I did a video last week talking about these side effects and how you can avoid some of them and just things you should know if you're considering taking metformin. So I'll link that video up above if you want to know more. But the reason that it's so effective comes down to the fact that it improves insulin sensitivity. And there are ways that you can do this naturally through diet and lifestyle changes. But before I get into that, I'm going to quickly take a moment to thank today's sponsor, ButcherCrowd. ButcherCrowd delivers high-quality grass-fed and finished meats, wild-caught seafood, and pasture-raised chicken and pork straight to your door. If you're focused on eating healthy, high-protein meals that support blood sugar balance and insulin sensitivity, ButcherCrowd is a great option. I personally love their grass-fed beef and wild-caught salmon, which are rich in healthy fats, protein, and essential nutrients like vitamin B12 and omega-3s. Now, if you want to check them out, you can head to healthcoachkate.com/butchercrowd. They deliver Australia-wide. And make sure to use code HCK15 at checkout because this is going to save you 15% off your first box. But now let's talk about how you can improve your insulin sensitivity naturally. So whether you have type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, or double diabetes, these strategies can help. Because all the things we're about to talk about help to reduce your body's need for insulin. So if you're type 1 diabetic, this is going to mean you need to inject less insulin. If you're type 2 diabetic, this means that your body is going to need to produce less insulin. And if you have double diabetes, same thing. You just need less insulin. And when our insulin levels are low, this is when our cells have a bit of a break. And this is when they become more insulin sensitive again, because they're not being constantly bombarded with high insulin levels. The first thing you're going to want to do is to reduce carbs in your diet and be smart about them when you do have them. Carbohydrates are the macronutrient that raises blood sugar the most, and in turn requires a lot of insulin to process. Eating fewer carbs means less insulin is needed, making blood sugar easier to control for both type 1 and type 2 diabetics. Many studies have shown that low-carb and ketogenic diets help to reverse type 2 diabetes, and they also help to improve blood sugar stability in type 1 diabetics. Again, reducing type 1 diabetics' need for insulin. The second thing you're going to want to do is focus on whole foods. Prioritize protein at every meal, especially high-quality animal protein. And I always recommend animal protein because it's the most bioavailable. Along with the protein, you also get a lot of micronutrients, iron, B12, CoQ10, nutrients that aren't as easy to absorb when we get them from plants and from plant protein sources. And with animal protein, it's also naturally low slash doesn't have any carbohydrates. With plant protein sources like beans and legumes, they are very high in carbs, and the protein isn't as bioavailable. So if you're trying to keep your carbohydrates low and get enough protein, animal protein is the way to go. The next thing you're going to want to do is to stop snacking, because the fewer times you eat throughout the day, the less your insulin is bumping up throughout the day. Stick to 2 to 3 quality meals. Make sure you're getting at least 30 grams of protein at every meal. Add some non-starchy vegetables, low sugar fruit, nuts, seeds, that sort of thing. Again, stick to whole foods. But the key here is making sure you're getting enough protein and enough fat. If you're eating enough at your meals, you're not going to be hungry for snacks in between. And in between your meals, your blood sugar and your insulin, it's going to come down to baseline. So you'll have more time throughout the day for your insulin sensitivity to improve. The fourth thing to do is to exercise regularly. So any type of exercise can be beneficial, although I highly recommend staying away from chronic cardio. This is things like running and cycling. If you're doing this type of cardio and you're able to stay in an aerobic state, aka you can hold a conversation, you're not breathing heavily, you can breathe entirely through your nose, then that could be beneficial. But a lot of people, they go for a run, they're breathing heavily, and they're not in that aerobic state. And when you're in an anaerobic state for long periods of time, this can actually make insulin resistance worse. So instead of going for a run, stick to lower intensity cardio, go for a walk, and resistance training. That can be so beneficial as well. This is a little bit of a hack because when you're exercising, your cells are actually able to take in glucose without insulin. So this is why exercise can be so beneficial for both type 1 and type 2 diabetics. And finally, consider taking a natural supplement, something like berberine or inositol. These are available over the counter and have been scientifically proven to help control blood sugar levels and improve insulin sensitivity. I'll link to some of my favorite brands in the description box down below. So to recap, type 2 diabetes is caused by insulin resistance and is reversible. Type 1 diabetes is an autoimmune disease that requires insulin. And double diabetes is where someone has type 1 diabetes, but they're also insulin resistant. And the best way to improve both is by lowering your need for insulin. Now, if you want to know some of the best foods you can eat for lowering insulin, I'm going to link a video up above that has over 100 foods that are great, because I know it can feel overwhelming and hard to figure out where to start. So that's where I'd recommend starting. If you do need a little bit more guidance and support, I do have a 7-day insulin resistance masterclass. It's a one-time fee. It includes a shopping list, a sample meal plan, and we can work together through a private Facebook group. So I'll put the link to that in the description box down below as well. I have a special discount code for my YouTube friends. That code is just YouTube. If you use that at checkout, you're going to save 15%. But let me know in the comment section if you have insulin resistance, type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes. Maybe you're a pre-diabetic and you're trying to prevent it from becoming type 2 diabetes. I'd love to hear from you guys. What has your experience been so far? Is there anything you've done that has helped you to improve your blood sugar, reduce your need for insulin if you're type 1 diabetic? I love hearing from you guys. And if you have any questions or future video topics you would like me to cover, leave those down below as well. Thank you guys for watching. And before you go, don't forget to check out ButcherCat. See you guys next time. Bye.